Hey girl, hey, welcome back to my channel. It's your girl Misha. Thank you guys for joining me yet again for another review. Tonight we are back with a brand new review of The Real Housewives of Potomac Season 6 Episode 9. If you are new here, then welcome. I give lighthearted reviews with a little bit of laughter and a little bit of shade. If you are back for a second or third time, then welcome back. Please do not hesitate to like, comment, and subscribe to my channel if you get anything out of the content. Now child, let's get into it if we gonna get into it. When the episode first opens up, you know, they show us a little montage, right? Ashley's at home changing poopy diapers, and Karen got those barking dogs out getting a foot massage, talking to Ray about getting two gowns or whatever for this vow renewal. So when the episode fully opens up, we see Mia and she's getting ready for lunch with her mom. So she calls in G so he can help her pick out an outfit, right? So he's helping her to pick out her ensemble, and they started talking about Mia going to meet with her mom. And so she was like, you know, I just want to tell her that I'm really proud of her, but I'm kind of hesitant to say anything wrong because if I do, I don't want her to relapse. In the next scene, Eddie, they're in the bed. Child, ever since this woman called that man Idris, I cannot unsee it. Do y'all hear me? Every time I see him, I'm just like, hey, Idris. Child, were you really with K. Michelle and whatnot? Child, I just want to ask some questions. So anywho, Wendy and Eddie are in the bed and they start talking, right? So Wendy was like, you know, it's just really funny because the person with a volatile marriage wants to talk about our marriage. So then Eddie pipes up and he's like, yeah, it's lies, lies, and more lies. The lies in my candy voice. Baby, Eddie said, it's a full-blown lie and the truth ain't in it, honey. So Eddie was like, you know, I live my life a certain way and that ain't it. And, you know, they went through so much just to get married. He turned his back against his family. He's like, we even told them our story. So why would she even repeat that? He was like, why would I even be doing all that out here moving funny in these streets when I did so much to even be with you? Honey, they do it every day, B. Shout out to Paid in Full. But they do. I mean, people cheat every day. But I really don't think there's any validity to this rumor. Giselle is just deflecting and diverting the attention to Wendy so people don't start questioning her about Bindergate. That is exactly what I feel. Now, I could be wrong. This might have some truth to it, and Idris is just a good actor. Okay, I mean, he deserves an Oscar. So I don't know what's going on. Okay, I don't know if it's real or I don't know if it's fake, but I know I'm tired of hearing about it. Okay? The bottom line is this. Your man ain't a cheater. She's already said she didn't mean it vindictively, even though we know she a bold-faced lie. Okay, so just take you and your happy marriage and your happy Ness and go skip on off into the sunset and stop worrying about what Giselle is talking about, honey. It's really irrelevant. She's a non-mother factor. Shout out to Evelyn Lozado. Child, anybody got time to be playing with Giselle? Wendy was like, you know, he went against his family to be with me, and that's why I reacted the way I did. And, you know, for her to bring up these old rumors, honey, not the old rumors. Eddie said, you know, hurt people project their hurt onto others. Preach, Eddie, honey, preach. Wendy's like, I don't expect them to understand my reaction because they've never had a man that loves them and they never will. All right, Meryl Streep, let's move forward, child. Moving forward. Giselle is at the Etch-A-Sketch house and Robyn comes over so they can do this sleepy time podcast, child. And she and her friend, Robyn, knew nothing about it, and now they have a podcast deal with iHeart. Child, if y'all handing out podcast deals, holler at your girl. Because I could definitely use one, honey. Please call me. Shout out to iHeart. This week, this episode is going to be about cheating. Now, let me tell you something. When they were doing this podcast or whatever they were doing, honey, because I don't even know if they were really recording a podcast. But what I think to me, and this may be a reach, is that this was all centered around what's been going on with Wendy. Why all of a sudden y'all want to have a whole podcast about cheating? Okay, you've been going through this for years, and now all of a sudden you want to have a podcast episode about cheating? Girl, goodbye. So their podcast is about cheating this week, suspicions and accusations. Honey, y'all better not let Wendy hear this episode. And what do y'all know about relationships? Honey, it's the blind leading the blind. So Giselle said Robyn and her looked up statistics. Child, y'all are the statistics, but honey, let's hear it. She's like, it said that 22% of men cheat. Okay, well, it's not as high as I thought. So then she said she did a mental survey of her girlfriends, and it's 100% correct. Honey, not surveying the girls when Jamal was in that number. Honey, let's look within. Like, let's look on the inside. Let's do some introspective work. Honey, don't be looking at your girlfriends. Look at you, honey. What's happening over here? So Giselle said, you know, what I wanted to know is, if they cheat once, will they cheat again? Well, honey, we know the answer to that. Absolutely. She was like, you know, they said that it was a 350% chance that they will cheat again. Girl, now she done made up these statistics to justify Jamal walking around the pulpit asking for tithes and phone numbers. Girl, goodbye. Child, I'm not about to play with you. Where did these statistics come from? Show me the Carfax, honey, because I'm not buying it. You done looked in that phone. Y'all done made us a 350%. Girl, okay. But I mean, you lived through it. So, I mean, I'm sure you know the statistics are correct. So she said, you know, I started thinking about my life and I said, dang, somebody should have told me that 2 years ago. So you're confirming Jamal did in fact cheat again, allegedly. Or was this Sherman? Because y'all remember she was talking to Sherman like 2 years ago, was it? I don't know, honey. It's only been two men. I'm a little bit confused. So then the producer said, well, what would you have done differently 2 years ago? She said, nothing. They said, oh, well, you were with Jamal and you said that, you know, if you had known then what you know now. She was like, oh, I was just joking. Girl, you ain't joking, honey. You a joking lie. It's okay, Giselle, honey. It happens to the best of us. We have all been there, one way or the other. Nobody deserves that treatment that Jamal gave you, honey. Jamal is for the pastoral streets. Don't worry about him, okay? But if you be real, you would be more endearing. It's like you're trying to get us to believe this facade that you're this tough woman and you don't care and Jamal made a mistake. And what are you even explaining anyway? You know, I can read all the statistics in the world, but, you know, I'm leaning on what Giselle knows. And I know that if you've been with a man long enough, he will cheat. Girl, no, not necessarily. All men do not cheat. Now, let me tell you something. I have been through some pretty crappy relationships. I ain't gonna lie to you. I've been battered, bruised, left for dead, honey, all kinds of stuff. But I do feel like one day God is going to bless me with my one, okay? So, I mean, I just can't say all of them cheat. I mean, and you just did say 22%. I mean, if we put 100% of them together and only 22% of them are cheating, then we have a percentage that's not. So, I mean, we just can't say they cheating just because they staying with you. Jamal is just not a good man. And that's just the bottom line. So she was like, you know, if they cheat once, you know, like at a bachelorette party because, you know, they lost their mind or whatever, that's cool. No, it's not. She was like, but, you know, when it's a lifestyle, then I'm going to have to choose me. Honey, it was definitely a way of life for Pastor Jamal, okay? She was like, because I care more about me than I do about the relationship. So Robyn was like, in her confessional, she's like, I'm not shocked that they aren't together. I never saw them together anyway. They weren't meant to be. Honey, we know you don't want them to be. Child, allegedly. Robyn in her yellow dress being shady in this confessional, y'all. I said, oh, now she's shading her friend. So Robyn was like, well, you know, my situation was different. We were married. He cheated. And then we got a divorce. But, you know, we were young. But I did say that I wasn't going to leave. I kind of like just turned a blind eye to it. And I respected Robyn for actually being real, because a lot of us women do that. You know, you already know what's going on, but you're trying to keep your family together, so you just act like it ain't happening. And I know she is probably not the only one. Honey, I am guilty of that. When my husband was around, you know, I was just trying to act like things weren't happening, crying late at night, honey, knowing he was cheating all up and through on me. Do y'all hear me? But I just was young and dumb, honey. So I was just like, you know what? I'm going to keep my family together. Child, please. Honey, so I really respected the fact that Robyn just laid it out and kept it real. And so Giselle was like, oh, I've never heard you say that before. She said, yeah, but I was young. But now, if you do that to me and you don't treat me right, I will definitely break up with you. Girl, no, you won't, honey. Juan won't even stay on the phone past 2 seconds. He don't even say I love you when he hang up. But it's nice to know you're learning. Moving forward, Giselle said, you know, I had to check in with my friend about her infidelity, but she thought I was being shady. Now, Giselle, listen to me. If your friend is thinking you're being shady and you call her a friend, then you're being shady, because I'm pretty sure your friend would know. Honey, they know what you be on. In the next scene, Candiace and Chris in her fancy top, honey, they sitting around talking about her music video that she has to shoot. So he's asking her about the choreography, and she told him about the trip and how it went, right? And she was like, yeah, you know, Giselle was being messy, and she said that you were riding my coattails. So then he let out like a little chuckle, right? Chris said, do they know that you have supported me when I first opened up my restaurant by being a hostess when I didn't have anybody else? You've been there for me, so now I'm just returning the favor. So Candiace, in her confessional, she was like, you know, Giselle has been scorned, so she's projecting her scornness onto my ebony and ivory love story. Girl, she was like, worry about yourself, witch. We're fine over here. Candiace, honey, where's that energy when you are with Giselle? It's okay to pipe up the same way you do on Ashley. You got all the smoke for Ashley, but I didn't hear any of that for Giselle. We don't want to hear it in the confessional. Say it when you're in person. So then she tells him about the bomb that Ashley dropped, and Chris said, well, maybe she didn't mean any harm. He go, Candiace, she did, because she gleefully got her milk right after that. Honey, I didn't see the glee. Okay, she looked at the camera and said that that was not the way that that was supposed to go. Candiace, you love to put some stank on something that Ashley has done. Honey, it's given very much hatred. Like, what is wrong with you? I didn't see the glee, but I did see her get the heck out of Dodge after Wendy came through like a wrecking ball. Now, I did see that. Moving forward. Ashley and the family go to find out why the baby is not latching, right? She said he has a tongue tie. And you know what? My son suffered from that, and they had to clip it. I actually did go the surgical route because I was like, you know, I want the lady patting him on the back and whatnot. Honey, clip it so we can get to eating so he can get to growing, okay? But she wanted to find another alternative way before they turn to surgery. So he's not eating, so she's up every hour feeding him, and she's so tired that she can't really give anything to Michael. So, honey, we know he probably been out with his extracurricular activities, allegedly. Child, he can't sit down for 5 minutes. I ain't never seen nobody like Michael in my life. So then Michael starts interviewing the lady. He's like, so tell me about your credentials. So then she says something. So tell me what your best results were with kids. So then she says something. He's like, do most people have good... Michael, would you stop the line of questioning and let the lady work? Honey, y'all sought her out. Didn't you do your research online? Honey, get on the Googler if you want the answer to all these questions. Honey, she ain't gonna do nothing but pat his back and burp him. It's going to be fine. So he's like, do you feel comfortable about it? Ashley was like, yeah, I'm actually very excited. Ashley is a goofy, I swear, honey. So she starts doing the baby massage. And she's like, yeah, he has some tension in his right arm. Child, y'all stressing the baby out. Honey, this is a fool. She did some abracadabra on the baby, honey, and rubbed him down and flipped him around and handed him right on back to Ashley. Honey, that took all of 5 minutes, but she probably did it so fast because she wanted him to get on out so Michael could go. Honey, he rubbed everybody wrong. They didn't even get to the car a good 5 minutes, and Dylan was knocked out. Honey, I know the feeling, Dylan. It feels nice and relaxing after you get a good massage. Honey, before COVID, shall I be all up in the massage of it all, getting my weekly massage, making sure I do my self-care. But that's just a side note. So as they're riding back, Ashley and Michael are talking, right? And, you know, they hope that the therapist actually helped Dylan so they can get some alone time and he can start getting more sleep. So she starts talking about him, you know, not watching her give birth because he may not find her sexually attractive. He was like, you think I'm looking at your vagina, but I was actually looking at my son being born. I can understand her concern because motherhood sometimes makes you feel like, you know, you don't have the zhuzh that you once had. So I understand you, Ashley. So here he go. She says, so do you mean that you still find me sexually attractive? Here go this idiot. He's like, yeah, and you know, you're quickly getting back into shape, which is great for me. Michael, have you seen you? Honey, what is that supposed to mean? And what if she wasn't getting back into shape quickly? Then what? Another one of those hotel receipts? He's like, and you know, you don't look overweight, so I'm very attracted to you. Well, I'm sure she's happy to hear that. Ugh, child, I know Ashley want to jump out of that car while it's moving, but her baby in the back seat. He is such a jerk. Oh my God. Moving forward, Robyn is having a talk with Carter about how she sits like a bump on a log when she could be doing more, and she tells him she needs to get a life coach. Robyn, you need a therapist as well. Her son was like, yeah, your life ain't together. Honey, and isn't. Honey, it'd be your own kids. So Robyn decided for her birthday that she would gift herself a life coach. Why are you A, putting this on this child? Where is Juan? Okay. And B, why are you having the conversation with the lady in front of him? I really don't think Robyn is being realistic. You need a therapist. I don't think you're just being lazy. It's really something more. Now, I know she says that she's in a happy place mentally and all of this, but I just don't think so. In the next scene, me and her mom, they go for lunch, right? And she wants to build a relationship with her. They start talking about her grandkids and how her daughter acts just like Mia, right? And so her mother was like, yeah, and you act just like your dad. So her mom said, you know, I used to look at you and I would be like, oh, she gets on my nerves because she responds and acts just like her dad. Well, dang, that's not something you say to your child. I mean, I know she's a grown woman, but, oh, that's a sensitive subject. And I kind of feel like this should have been left off camera, but we do want to get to know the real, okay? And we do appreciate Mia actually opening up and letting us witness this. It was hard to watch, but it was actually transparent, and I appreciated it. So, you know, they're talking and she's like, so what happened with my dad? So, you know, her mom just proceeded to say, she said, you know how you got that burn on you? She said, what happened was you were making some oatmeal and then you burned yourself. And so they called me and they told me to come home. And I was thinking, why should I come home? Because her dad is there. And when I got home, I found your dad in the basement with another woman. And she was like, I told him he had to get out. She said, but a few days later, I wanted to be back with him and I told him to come back. She said, I actually tried to commit suicide behind your dad. And I was just like, oh, wow. And then she also said, you know, your dad is the one who introduced me to drugs. And I'm like, oh, my goodness. No wonder she resents Mia because, first of all, Mia and her dad are close, or she said they were close. I don't know if he's deceased. I don't know if he's still living. I'm not quite sure. But not only that, but her mannerisms, the way that she behaves, the way she carries herself, she's very outgoing, very charismatic, and that, all of that wrapped into one reminds Mia's mom of her dad. And that's somebody that causes her pain even to just think about, because she didn't even really want to talk about it. And you know what? It's just so sad because there are a lot of moms out there who do treat their children like that based on how they behave. Like I even had a friend one time and she had a son and he reminded her a lot of his dad. And she would always be like, I can't stand him. He reminds me of his daddy. That is not their fault, honey. It's in their DNA. Of course, they get something from you and they get something from their father. So of course, there's going to be things that remind you of the other parent. But it's our job to not let what happened between us spill over into our relationship with our children. And I just felt so bad for Mia in that moment. And I'm like, oh, okay, well, Mia the entertainer, I really felt for you in this scene, and I am so happy that you allowed us in. Moving forward, Karen and Wendy and Mia, they go to meet up to go wedding dress shopping. And she's like, this is not my first dress. This is my second. My first dress, I went over budget. You know, it was $10,000, came from Turkey. Okay, honey, you better drop a bag like it's your first time getting married, Karen. Wendy gets there, right? Blending in with the decor and whatnot. Honey, Wendy, you look good, okay? You're looking good. And I love the boots. So here comes Mia. She's like, oh, industrial. This is a warehouse. Girl, come on inside, honey. It looks gorgeous on the inside. Don't worry about what's happening outside. So she gets in. She sits down and she's talking to Wendy while Karen is trying on dresses. So they start talking and Mia's like, you know, I haven't seen you. Wendy was like, yeah, you know, I felt like something happened. When I got home, I felt like I got hit by a Mack truck. So Mia was like, girl, something did happen. You remember all the stuff? Honey, yeah, we remember. So then Mia in her confessional, she said, look, I really feel like it was unfair that Giselle did that and was speaking on her marriage. She should have brought it straight to Wendy. Yes, as she should. But you know, I think it's good to see these two playing nice. So Karen comes out in the first dress. It's stunning. She goes in to try on the second dress. Honey, no. Those sleeves, the dress, just the whole thing of it all, honey. It's a hell no. Please, go back in and change. So she goes in to try this on. She comes out. She twirls around. She can't even sit down. So Wendy was like, ooh, this is going to be so nice here. And then, so then Mia said, oh, it's here? Yes, honey, it's here. This is the venue. So Wendy was like, yeah, this is the venue. She said, well, the interior is perfect, but we might need to get a runner for outside. Child, Candy and Todd got married at an industrial space and it was fine. Honey, you can work magic in these spaces. It's all about the creativity. I also like the element of surprise. You know, you pull up thinking it's an abandoned warehouse, then boom, pop out with a beautiful space. I love it. When you walk in, honey, it's built to last. Listen, but it can stand to be zhuzhed just a little bit on the outside. But Mia hush. So Karen did a little lean, honey, because she cannot sit down. And then Mia tells them, she said, look, I got a text about a meetup for drinks for Robyn's birthday, but you two weren't on it. Giselle sent the text. Baby, y'all know Mia gonna tote a message if she don't do nothing else. Giselle always trying to exclude people from things. Girl, nobody want to be nowhere where you are. So then they asked Gizzard in her ponytail why she didn't invite the other ladies. Here she go. This is Robin's happy birthday. You know, I want people there that love and support Robin and wish her a happy birthday. They didn't, so these heifers ain't invited. Well, she didn't say heifers, honey. She called them something else, which I don't really respect her calling them out of their name like that. Like, why are you calling them pros? For what? Like, what good is that gonna do? Now, honey, when they clap back, then you're gonna be sitting there sipping your mojito looking crazy. Stop doing that. So she was like, these heifers ain't invited. Child, nobody want to sit around y'all and watch y'all order the same crab cake and Caesar salad? No way. Child, I'm pretty sure they're fine. So Wendy was like, well, I haven't talked to her, so I didn't expect to be invited. And I wouldn't want to be invited somewhere where I don't get along with the person. Don't invite me somewhere to have me involved in more confrontation. I'm good. Karen said, you know, she's really hurt. And you don't kick a dog when they're down, when they're wounded. And so Wendy was like, well, the wounded dog shouldn't kick you either. Well, honey, y'all speaking in riddles and whatnot. Like, what are you really trying to say? So Karen said, you know, if she really in her mind thought she was in a relationship and she's hurting, you know, she would get the support that she needs even from me. Honey, not in her mind. Not she in a relationship in her mind. Karen, now you know Giselle is not about to open up to none of y'all. And quiet as it's kept, you just want to hear her admit defeat. Do y'all like each other or nah? Honey, that's what I really need to know. She's like, there's some shame and pain there. So, you know, she said, and because of the person I am, I'm going to send this message through you, Mia. Child, are you sure, honey? Mia, she likes to miscommunicate things. I would not send a message through Mia. Honey, ain't no telling what she going to say when she get back. She said, if she sends me a text and says she regrets using the word death, then I will forgive her. Karen, hush, okay? Hush. That lady did not literally mean she wanted Ray to croak, okay? It's getting a little tired. Now, I done took all I can take now. Lady, I'm speaking directly to you. Let that go. Ugh. Moving forward, Candiace, another one of her head wraps, and Chris, they go grab a bite to eat. Candiace hasn't worn one of those heavy 700% density wigs this season. Does she still have that hairline? I wonder. Because, you know, she love a good heavy wig with a bad part. So they order, and, you know, in her confessional, she's talking about all of the pressure from her music video. So then they start talking about the schedule, and she's shooting the music video soon, but Chris has to work, so he's not going to be able to be there, right? Because he's doing the same, doing something at the same time that she is. So Candiace is like, what if something goes wrong? He said, there will be other people there in place. He said, there will be other people there to help you. Candiace is like, well, why are you working during this time? He said, that's when I was booked. She's like, I can't focus. I don't know if everything's going to be in place. He's like, you don't trust that I'll have everything in place? See, listen. This is why you need a real manager, someone that is devoted to Candiace and all things music and your career, because he has a day job. So, I mean, I know it sounded good in theory, but not good in real life. Honey, you just like the way Husbandger sounds. Chris is not doing nothing, okay? So, I mean, you really just need to employ a real manager. He's like, stop putting your nose in it. I'm going to have it taken care of. She's like, no, I'm not. You're never there. So then they show flashbacks of him always missing in action. He's like, it's no big deal. I volunteered to do this ish. Child, what happened to it's your turn to support her? Did she treat you that way when she was hosting at the restaurant table for two right this way? Was she acting a fool then? Child, Chris was acting a plum nut in this scene. Do y'all hear me? So then he starts getting an attitude. He's like, let me just drop everything, ask you for an allowance, and not work because I don't have a job anymore because I want to wait on you hand and foot. She's like, I need you to figure out what this little attitude is because I will cuss you the freak out. I know that's right, y'all. So he gets up and leaves her sitting there and sticks up with the check. That was his plan all along, child. I would be pissed if my husband left me sitting at that table with that chick. Child, no ma'am, Pam. In the final scene, the heifers meet up for Robin in her New Year's Eve top to show up for a dinner, right? So Robin been hanging with Giselle entirely too long because the fashions are rubbing off on her as well. So Giselle walks in and she's talking to the people at the front. She's talking to the hostess. She's like, it's my friend's birthday. We need a birthday special, honey, whatever that is. Lady, it's a piece of cake with happy birthday written on a plate and your server singing a song. Honey, that's exactly what it is. You should have brought your own decorations. Child, don't come here demanding these people to make it special. You didn't have time to put some zhuzh on it? Girl, goodbye. So the ladies show up empty-handed, of course, with the exception of a scholar, because, you know, she got class and whatnot. And I'm just looking around. I'm like, where's the birthday gifts? Honey, you heifers better pin at least a dollar on them. You know Robyn can use every dollar she can get, child. Moving forward. All the other ladies start showing up. Ashley in her Beetlejuice pants. And then Candiace in yet another head wrap in these big white boots. As soon as she sits down, she's like, people are missing. Giselle said, are they? Giselle loves to be in charge. And we all know Robyn won't dare question the guest list. Okay? So Candiace said, I thought you were moving forward with Wendy. Honey, not moving forward. She said, I put it out there. And, you know, I said I wanted to have a private conversation. But it's off the table now because she never reached out to me. Candiace was like, well, dang, does it have an expiration date? Let's be real. Okay? It's best Wendy was not in attendance. But Giselle, ain't nobody working on your timeline, ma'am. You and your fashions need to reel it in. Okay? So Escala is like, she spoke so highly of you, though, Giselle. So here she go. Well, she should have known that I wasn't being shady. Well, should she? Because, I mean, I feel like everything you do is a little bit of shade. But that's just me. Just then, Robyn and her braids, they show up. Happy birthday, girl. Soon as she sits down, here go Giselle. She's like, well, you know, there was some conversation about the ladies that aren't here. Is this her birthday brunch or a gossip session? So then Robyn was like, well, what happened? Candiace said, I thought y'all were good. Robyn said, you know, we did talk, but it was like unresolved. And in her confessional, she's like, you know, even though she apologized, I still feel like I was getting a condescending, snarky reporter. Robyn, you were not thinking about calling her a reporter until Giselle said she sounded like she was talking to y'all like she was on CNN. Robyn does not have an original thought in her mind. Charlotte is crazy. You want to stay mad because she's still on the outs with Giselle. Once she get over it, you are going to miraculously be cool with Wendy too. Honey, let's just call a spade a spade. So Giselle said, Ashley, I got to ask you this though. Did you add some hot sauce? Ashley was like, no. I said, I'm asking, are you and Eddie reinvigorating your sex life because of this blog? So then a scholar goes, well, that's saying you're assuming that the blogs are true. Finally, somebody with some sense. Honey, that is what pissed her off. You weren't concerned. You were basically saying, well, we know he's cheating. So is that why you suddenly changed? Is that why you have boobs? A scholar was like, she feels attacked. So then Candiace is like, this filthy milkmaid, this is what she's saying in her confessional. She drove 4 hours to ruin my trip. First of all, Candiace, honey, cut the jabs at her motherhood, filthy milkmaid and all this kind of stuff, forehead, breast milk. Cut it out, girl. No matter how messy Ashley is. Second, Giselle is the one that ruined your trip. She knew you did not invite Ashley, but she did it anyway. Maybe you should have just brought Wendy with you since we don't have to run it past the host. Honey, give that energy back. Give that energy that you're giving to Ashley to Giselle. She's the one that ruined your trip. And she gave the message to Ashley, and Ashley totaled it on over to Wendy. So then she calls Ashley a pro. I was like, oh, child, here they go with that word again. She called her something that rhymes with pro, but y'all know I won't be using that here on this channel. And Ashley is like, you have no leg to stand on. Candiace is like, you brought your wide body self to Williamsburg, then took off with your breast milk. Child, we're gonna have to get some better material, okay? Look, I usually offer read classes on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, but I mean, I can make an exception for you on Labor Day and whatnot. Candiace, call me, honey, because I'm gonna have to teach you how to read. Because right now, what you're doing is you're insulting her. You're not reading her. You're insulting her. There's a difference. You know, you got to be quick with it. Kind of like what she said about me and her big feet. Now, that was a read. But what you're doing to Ashley, you're body shaming her. You know, you're talking about her being a mom. She's already faced postpartum before. And that's a very real thing. And I mean, you really need to mature. Child. And Candiace, you just really do too much. And what does any of that have to do with this? So Ashley was like, oh, I'm wide body now, and y'all want to talk about body shaming, right? So then Candiace was like, I'm not body shaming you, ma'am. Well, then what is it? I'm a little bit confused. She's like, you walk into a room and body shame yourself with your big face and your big forehead. Oh, that heifer know how to be mean spirited, don't she? Listen to me, that mouth on Candiace, I would have chewed her up and spit her out. Do y'all hear me? You got to be an A1 reader to get with somebody like Candiace, because she talks out of the side of her neck. Child, I would really have her pulling out those triangular tissues. Child, she got the right one with Ashley. We know you cannot stand Ashley, okay, Candiace? We got it. But calling her a pro and a wide-bodied, big forehead, big-faced heifer, come on, child, come on now. That's the anger that you have towards Chris. You got mad with him because he doesn't want to see you drive back. Wanna be right back, or whatever that song say, child. You mad because he ain't going to be seeing you there to drive back, and you taking it out on Ashley. And you only do this to Ashley. Wasn't Ashley the one that brought you into this group? Child, this ongoing beef that these two got is a fool. Do y'all hear me? And that was the end of the episode. Child, the episode didn't really give much zhuzh. I mean, it was okay. I did the best that I could do on what I was given. But please don't hesitate to comment, like, subscribe to my channel. Comment down below and tell me exactly how you felt about the episode. Do you feel like Candiace was being a brat? Because I sure do. Do you feel like Ashley deserved to be called wide-bodied, even though she can get a little bit messy? But honey, she's just playing a role. All these heifers messy. And as always, stay safe, stay blessed, spread love, not germs.